Hey everyone, in this video we're going to take a look at functional programming, and I'm going to show you why it's one of the best ways of writing clean and concise Swift code that's also thread safe, and how it differs from your more traditional imperative programming. If that sounds interesting, stay tuned. Alright, let's try and understand the need for functional programming in the first place. Let's take a look at this small code snippet. You can see that when it runs, like you would expect, it doubles all of the numbers in the input array. But this is also a problem because now we no longer have access to the original values in the input array. They've all been replaced now with 2, 4, 6, 8, and 10. So we have no way of getting those original values back. And that's the key difference between imperative and functional programming. Imperative programming says that it is totally okay to change the state of the application, introduce side effects like this, and overall modify the state of the application during execution. And functional programming takes the opposite stance. It says that under no circumstances are we allowed to introduce any side effects or make any changes to the state of the program as it's running. It values immutability above everything else. And because functional programming works that way, it's inherently thread safe because it's not introducing any side effects or changing any of the states of any of the variables or any other characteristics of your program. You can find more information about the difference between imperative and functional programming in the blog post linked below, but for the time being, let's look at some examples in Swift. All right, so we've got some examples here, and I'll go through these rather quickly because I want to show you a real-world example towards the end. So starting with this on line 4, we have this input array, and we want to call map on it. Now map, you can see, is going to take in a closure. So let's go ahead and define our closure. And the way that we work with closures here in functional programming in Swift is we use this $0 syntax. And what this is saying is that eventually $0 is going to be every single value in the input array. So just for a little bit more context here, map is saying that we're going to go through every item in this input array and we're going to do something to it. Right, so we could very easily, we could add 2 to it, we could multiply it by 2, whatever operation we want to do, we can do within the brackets here. But $0 is a placeholder for every item in the input array that will eventually be substituted out in this closure. So what this is saying is, you know, for the first iteration, it's going to be 1 multiplied by 2, then 2 multiplied by 2, 3, and so on. And you'll see here that the main takeaway is that this is returning another array. It's not actually modifying the input array, but it's returning an entirely separate array with some transformation applied to it. In this case, multiplying all the numbers by 2. So you can see that the output would just be the input multiplied by 2, but our original input numbers are not modified at all. And now we can go look at compact map. Now compact map works the same way, where it applies some function to every element in the array, but it's going to get rid of any nil values. So we can see here that what we're trying to do is we're saying grab every element in our compact map input array, try and convert it to a double. All right, and of course my name is going to fail because that can't be converted to a double. So you'll see that in the output it's not included because, you know, here on line 15, when this gets replaced with my name, that will get resolved to nil. And it won't be included because we're using compact map. So otherwise, this would be a fair bit of code to write in your conventional like for loop syntax, but here it's just one line. And one quick point to mention here is that you actually don't need these outer parentheses. You can just simply write it like this. So it's just a little bit cleaner. And now we'll go ahead and talk about flat map. Now flat map is interesting. It's used for instances where you have a sequence of sequences. So in this case, you can see that we have an array that contains arrays. And let's say we wanted to flatten that down to just a one-dimensional array of all of those elements. And in that circumstance, we would use flat map. So you can see that running flat map on this input brings everything down into this one-dimensional array. So that is a good starting point that covers the variations of map that Swift provides. Alright, so now we'll look at the final set of functional programming options in Swift. So let's start with reduce, which is pretty cool. So we have this input array, and what we're saying is with reduce, we want to take some array and distill it down to just a single value. So in this case, what we want to do is we want to sum up all of the numbers in this input array. So we say that the final value we want is going to start off with 0. And then for every new element that you consider, we want to take that value, that new element, and add it to whatever the starting condition was. So in other words, what it's saying is that we're starting with 0, and as we see each new element in this input array, we're going to add it to our running total. So what this is going to do is it's going to go ahead and add up all of the numbers here, and we will get 10 at the end of it. This can also be written more simply as this, which is just a nice shorthand to know in case it comes up. And now here's a slightly better example. We have the string hello, and what we're doing is we're saying that we're going to start off with an empty string, so no text. And it's going to say for every new character that it encounters as it's iterating through the characters in this word, we're going to take the old string or we're going to add the new string at the end. So this has the effect of reversing all the characters in the string. So reduce can start off with any starting condition here, any data type really, and then you can specify exactly what transformation happens in this closure. So you could do things like calculating averages, reversing strings, adding numbers. It's really, really useful. So now let's continue on. We'll talk about filter, which is a lot easier to understand. And filter is pretty simple. All it's saying is that it's going to take the input array that you've given it, and for every single element in the input array, it's going to check some conditional statement, and if that conditional statement is true, it's going to include it in the output. So for example, we have the numbers here 1 through 10, and this conditional statement is checking that a given number is even. So it's going to check every single element here. It'll check if it's even, and only the numbers for which this condition is true, it will include in the output. And just take note that this is returning an array, and reduce is returning whatever data type you specify here as a first parameter. So now for each. For each, unlike the other options, is not really returning anything. It's just a nicer way of writing a for each loop. So instead of having to say for item and items, we can just write it like this. And we can perform whatever we want on the value in the array, but just keep in mind that $0, that particular variable that it's referencing, that data is still immutable. It's just an easy way of iterating through a set of data. And finally, we have sorted, which is also pretty intuitive. It allows you to specify a custom way of sorting an inputted array of values. And in this case, I'm using numbers. It could be strings. It could be custom objects. It could really be anything you want. And then here in a closure, you specify exactly how it should sort these elements. So in this case, because it's numbers and we want it descending, we have this less than sign. But imagine that we had, imagine that we had objects here. We could sort by a property on the object. We could say that we want to sort by first names, right? So we could say something like the first comparison. So comparison is between two objects, right? So the first object's first name versus the second object's first name. And in that way, we could sort a custom object. So these are just a few of the commonplace functional programming options in Swift. So now let's move on to a real-world example. All right, so let's take a look at this real-world example. And you'll see that functional programming really becomes powerful when we can combine all of these functional programming style calls together. So we're going to start with a really simple car struct, and then from there I have an array of optional car objects, right? And some of these are nil and some of these are valid cars. And the task here is to return all of the valid cars, so the ones that are not nil, that have a horsepower greater than 300 and are sorted by descending price. Now typically this would be a lot of code to write, but I want to show you how we can do this in just one line using functional programming. So let's go ahead and start. So we'll say from the cars array, we want to get rid of the values that are nil. And we know that compact map is useful for that. So we can go ahead and say this, which is going to return a new array, which is going to take cars, remove all of the nil items, and return a new array. Now we know that we want to filter by horsepower. So we can just go ahead and say horsepower greater than 300. So this is saying whatever array that compact map returned, now let's additionally filter those elements by this horsepower criteria. And then the final thing we want to do is we want to sort. And so we can say sorted. And we know that sorting requires two elements, right? So we can say the first element that it's going to consider, the price, we want that to be greater than the second element, price. So in effect, this is going to sort the prices in descending order. And the final thing we need to do is we'll just go ahead and print it out just so we can verify the results here. All right, let's go ahead and run it. And you can see here in the console below, we get exactly the result we would expect. And we've accomplished quite a bit of functionality in just one line of code that I would argue is still quite readable. And this type of programming, functional programming, is crucial to how Swift UI and Combine work. And everything that we've done has still managed to be thread safe and concise and clean. So I hope you enjoyed this video. If you have any future video requests, please leave it in the comment section below. Otherwise, please like, comment, and subscribe. Thanks.